Hello, friend, and welcome to Borgcast Original Series 2.1 with Peter and Amory.
Hello!
And we cover Catspaw. What a start. Written by Robert Block, the famous US horror writer, author of Psycho. This is the second of his Trek episodes. He previously written What a Little Girl's Made Of.
That wasn't any good either, was it?
It wasn't great. He based this one on a short story he'd already written. I already don't want to read it.
Yep.
Directed by... Go on, guess.
I don't know.
Well, of course it must be Joseph Peveney.
Right.
Because every other episode is.
Fine.
It's like an assembly when I ask questions and 50% of the answers are always Jesus. Kids have worked that one out, bless them. Anyway, this first aired on the 27th of October, which is a bit of an early Halloween treat, but a lot closer than some specials that Jim Moon has talked about
yes.
on his podcast.
So. Yes. Yeah.
Captain's log, stardate 3018.2. Crewman Jackson is dead.
Captain Kirk, there is a curse on your ship.
Temperature, sir. It keeps rising.
We're burning up, sir.
Stop!
So you're on the Enterprise, there's no answer from the landing party, then eventually there is one to beam up. But just Crewman Jackson, who then promptly dies.
Yeah, played by Jimmy J. Jones, who wasn't familiar with Star Trek and had to ask his neighbour's son what beam me up meant. He'll return several times, including as different Enterprise crew members. But yeah, more of a stunt performer than an actor, it has to be said. And did you notice the music's a little jazzier to begin with as well?
No.
They've jazzed up the theme a bit, trying to appeal to the youth.
Right.
Not the only unwise decision they've made on that front, as we'll get to.
And then, without moving his lips, his voice, well, a voice comes through him-ish. You only know it's coming through him because that's what the camera's focused on. But actually,
yeah, there's no sense of it.
There's no sense of it at all. There's a curse on the ship. There's your teaser.
Ooh.
So, this makes sense. Everybody important beams down.
Assistant
chief engineer. Well, surely that's deputy chief engineer, or just an engineer. DeSalle in charge.
Yeah, you've got Uhura there on the bridge. So he should be down in engineering while Scotty's gone with her in charge. But apparently the studio interfered and they didn't want a black woman in command. A boo. Yeah. DeSalle was last seen in this side of paradise in the Squire of Gothos before that, and he was in Command Gold back in those days. It's nice to have the character back continuity-wise, but Michael Barrier is a tad wooden, it has to be said. I'd much rather have Uhura in charge.
Yeah, it would have been awesome. She'd have rocked.
Yeah.
Anyway, Scotty and Sulu in the landing party haven't been heard from, and it's Kirk, Spock and McCoy who beam down, which makes no sense.
Yeah.
The sensors have said there's nothing there, and then Spock gets readings of life forms. He asks Uhura, so Captain Wooden asks Chekhov. It's his first appearance with fucking terrible hair.
Yes, the terrible hair is another attempt to appeal to the youth. Well, the reason why it's a wig at the moment is because he hasn't grown his hair out yet. But Walter Koenig was hired to appeal to the youth market. Wow. Hence the Beatles styling.
Except it's not. It just looks like a scruffy mess. I mean, it might not be my cup of tea, but it looks better later, presumably when it's his actual
hair. Yes. The story goes that he was going to be English, but Roddenberry decided to respond to Russian complaints that there were no Soviets in space, unlike their trailblazing role in reality. The trouble with this, of course, is that the original series wasn't broadcast in the USSR at the time due to a little thing called the Cold War, so that can't really be the case, can it? But they needed an extra character because George Takei had a load of movie work. I mean, as it is in this episode, Sulu doesn't have any speaking lines whatsoever, so it's no wonder Taco was seeking other work.
Mm.
Yeah. Prior to this, Koenig had appeared in Roddenberry's The Lieutenant. But post-original series, his career was hardly busy, I think it's fair to say, when it comes to TV and film. He was a voice on the real Ghostbusters. He played Vladimir Pavel Maximov.
Wow.
So presumably JMS was getting him in to do a Russian voice as a nod. Of course, then once JMS had cast him as Bester in Babylon 5,
yeah,
the world woke up to the fact that he was more than just Chekhov.
Yeah.
And his career in TV took off a bit.
He's awesome in Babylon 5.
Yes.
So Chekhov says, no, it's only the three life signs. But then there's interference between them, and then there's fog. And then there's three terrible mask, papier-mâché puppet hag things.
They're not puppets, they're human beings, don't you know?
Well, there's terrible makeup then.
I thought it was all right. I mean, what's not so great is they're supposed to be disembodied heads, but you can quite clearly see they've got bodies that are dressed in black, but that they haven't matched the background properly. Never mind.
They say a rhyme because that matters.
It's all supposed to be sort of Shakespearean, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, which doesn't work though, does it really? Spock points out that it was poetry because we wouldn't have
very
known.
Very bad poetry.
Yeah, but we wouldn't have known if he hadn't said. And then said they're not real, but the life signs are. McCoy spots the entrance to Castle Grayskull, which is the source of the life signs, not on sensors, but it is on Spock's tricorder. And then Dax appears.
Yeah, the cat's quite a good actor, actually.
Yeah, best actor in this, probably. And them having gone into the castle, on the Enterprise, Chekhov says their life signs are no longer registering. So he's told to recalibrate your sensors or get help if he needs it. And he's like, oh, I'm not green, I can do it. So then in the castle, they fall down a hole and the cat meows. Now they're prisoners in a castle. McCoy is a nice sort of come to as they're prisoners and he stares at a skeleton.
Yeah, and Kirk goes to say bones and then changes his mind and says Doc instead,
yeah,
which is a great line.
Yeah. And then it's pointed out that these are all things from Earth, so there's nothing scarily Vulcan, if you see what I mean. It's like a human nightmare or ghost stories. Sulu and Scotty enter and they look zombie-like and Scotty's pointing a phaser. McCoy thinks they're drugged because they're not blinking. Sulu releases them, they're going to have a fight, and they're in a room with a very bad magician-looking man on a throne, and he's called something like Coral.
Korob.
Right.
Played by Theodore Makous. He was in two episodes of The Man from U.N.C.L.E., was different characters, 60s Batman, and some of the rest of the usual suspects as well. He's a serviceable actor. I mean, he looks ridiculous. That's not his fault. Apparently the robe was recycled from a Gilligan's Island.
Those poor people.
McHugh sadly died in a car crash a month after this episode aired.
Oh, gosh.
He'd been decorated for his service in the US Navy in World War II, so... Mm. You know.
Yeah, he seems to think the cat is talking to him, which, you know, it turns out later, yeah, it is. There's a bang of a gong and then there's a feast, but McCoy says he's not hungry, so he magic ups jewels, but they're crap and look fake.
Yeah, it's interesting that Kirk points out they can manufacture these on the Enterprise, so that's hinting towards the post-currency future that
yeah.
more solidifies in Next Generation.
So then Bollock, or whatever his name is...
Kolob.
Isn't that Bollock backwards?
No, that would be Borok.
Okay. Borok, which is Bollock if you're saying it wrong. Bollock says that they've passed tests of loyalty and bravery and they can't be bribed. Well, that's not true. They can't be bribed with shit they've already got.
Yes, exactly.
The cat tells him something and fucks off, and then a woman appears with the same necklace. Oh, I wonder what's going on here.
It's
and,
Sylvia, which is such
but not a... Daisy Pouncer, which would have been better.
Yes, such a 60s name. Played by Antoinette Bauer, who is also in The Usual Suspects, including three different roles in Mission Impossible. She was born in London, but moved to Canada at an early age. I think she's really good, actually. It's a great performance. She goes from controlling to seduced to anger on a dime, basically. It's pretty impressive.
The wig's bad, though.
The wig ain't great, but those were the days. Those were the days, my friend.
So then she's trying to hypnotise McCoy with the jewel, but Kirk gets the phaser from Scotty. But then Bollock says that he has the power. Clearly he thinks he's He-Man.
They've been doing some mind probing, apparently.
Yeah.
You are authorised to use the mind probe.
What? No, not the mind probe.
And then you get her saying, oh, tell me about the power. How does it feel? And he gets flirty and it's all sort of, I can give you anything and you excite me and it's all, ugh. And Bollock is watching. So then she's like, I can be any woman. And so she changes to a woman with blonde hair.
That happens later.
Oh, right. Well, I can't be arsed with any of the rest.
Right. So shall I take over then? Because you are losing the will to live rapidly here, aren't you?
Yes. Bollocks. I'm going to drink beer.
Kirk steals a phaser off Scotty and points it at them, but then Sylvia dangles a Christmas tree bauble version of the Enterprise over a candle, claiming to have killed Jackson with a similar image of him. On the ship, the crew are roasting and Kirk gives in. Sylvia tells Korobov for telling them too much about the nature of their powers. It's an interesting dynamic between the two baddies, at least. Korob encases the Model Enterprise in a Perspex cube, so it looks like a paperweight now, trapping the crew within a force field. DeSalle attempts to break through using the phrase, "I bet you credits to Navy beans," which is a tad anachronistic in many, many ways. Sylvia threatens to drain information from them, and when Kirk refuses to cooperate, they're all taken to their cell, with the exception of McCoy, who then gets brain-drained or whatever it is. Spock theorises that Korob missed when he tried to read their minds, hitting the subconscious fears and building an environment according to that. Wow, tenuous.
Yeah, just a tad.
McCoy returns zombie-ized. Sylvia and Korob argue. Ironically, given their final form, she accuses him of being a puppet. Well, you both are, love. She likes their new forms with their sensations flouncing around in her dress. She's clearly in charge and the more powerful of the two, which is a cool dynamic. Kirk is brought in and he tries Route 01, basically, here. Seduction. Be fair, not something he's deployed up to this point in the series, I don't think, but I have a horrible feeling this is going to crop up a lot more. Korob is watching and looks less than happy. Well, he would be, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
Sylvia tries...
Well, no, I mean, you know, he might be otherwise excited. You never know.
Mm. Sylvia tries...
Might be having a crafty wank behind the screen.
Well, that's a lovely image. Thank you. With his wand. Yeah.
Don't touch the wand.
Don't touch the wand, as they say later on. Yes. Sylvia, this is where Sylvia tries out a few new looks, but settles on her original one, so that was fairly pointless. Kirk probes her for information, so to speak, but then she realises he's using her, so it's back off to the dungeon, and not in a good way. Korob goes to see Kirk and Spirk and releases them, having also released the ship. Kirk refuses to leave without his men, but Korob says Sylvia won't let them, fearing she'll destroy them all if they don't escape soon. Then they're threatened by the shadow of a cat, which then moves down a scaled-down set. Wow, not massively convincing.
No, no.
Korob is crushed by the cell door with a black cat back projected into the doorway really badly.
Oh, it's terrible. It's absolutely fucking awful.
Kirk tries to save him to no avail, so then steals his wand, because you would. Then McCoy and the others attack, with Sulu employing some dubious martial arts moves, it has to be said. Having overcome their comrades, Kirk and Spock make use of the threat of the wand against the shadow of the cat. Believe it. Who wrote this? We're Robert Block. Which turns into Sylvia off-screen, of course. This is where Spock says, "Don't let her touch the wand, Captain." It'll go off. She transports Kirk to the dining hall, threatening him with her phaser and proclaiming... He destroys the wand. No, a broken wand. And they're all returned to the planet surface where a couple of feeble puppets die.
Oh, they look like something from the Clangers or something. It's fucking awful.
Clearly made from pipe cleaners. I mean, it's
yes, it's bad. It's like...
terrible.
If that was a Blue Peter make, you'd pity it.
Apparently in the remastered edition, they digitally remove the obvious wires. Wow.
That's going to make a massive difference. Yeah, exactly. It's going to look really, really, really special.
I've made a point now of starting to watch the remastered ones, and yeah, it really doesn't make any difference at all.
Any of the stuff with the cat any better?
Nope. No, they redo the castle, which is a bit pointless because it looks fine. But yeah, all the crap stuff they leave in.
Okay.
The sounds they make as they die are apparently infant alligators calling for their mum.
Right.
Which is almost as tragic as this story.
Yeah.
So yes, season 2 kicks off with yet more superpowered aliens. Hooray! But these ones are very, very silly. This story also introduces the idea that such aliens will become fascinated with human sensations, which will also crop up again.
Yeah.
The Halloween theme is very silly.
Yeah.
Kirk solving everything by smashing the wand, a feeble ending, and those puppets.
Oh.
Wow.
Yeah.
You could have had the young New Mexican puppeteer. It's all the people all lived in fear. He thought that maybe they'd listen to a puppet telling them what to do. And now he got some string and he got some wood. He did some carving and he was good. And folks came running so they could hear the young New Mexican puppeteer. They should have played that as they died. That would have
been
almost
amusing.
Rescued the episode.
Can you do that for Tumblr?
Possibly. Yeah. You were impressed, weren't you?
Yes,
I could tell. Yeah. Probably just as well that Quinn wasn't in this evening to watch this, I think.
Yeah.
Would have put them off.
They did ask about it, and I said it was crap and not in a good way.
Yeah. As unfortunately is quite often the case, there wasn't enough in it.
No.
And what there was pretty damn feeble.
Oh, God, it was awful.
And this is what they chose to open the season with. Except, of course, this isn't the broadcast order, so probably just as well. But, hey.
So which one did they broadcast first?
Oh, no, I'm glad you asked me that, because it means I have to look it up. You git. They opened with A Mock Time, which is a much better season opener, isn't it?
Yes. Yes, much, much better.
Whereas this one showed 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7th.
Yeah, they were just like, that weren't very good, was it? We need to sort of...
Yeah, there was some stonking episodes before this one, so yeah.
Yeah, now A Mock Time's good.
But, you see, we have to do it in this order because it explains Chekhov's hair.
God! You don't need to put the hair jingle in.
Yes, I suppose I do. Give me a head with hair. Long, beautiful hair. Shining, gleaming, screaming, flaxen, waxen. Give me down to there. Hair, shoulder length, longer. Here, baby, there, mama. Everywhere, daddy, daddy. Hair. Grow it, show it. Long as I can grow my hair. There we go. Shall we find out what people thought of this classic trek?
Yeah, did anybody like it? Probably not.
What did Boss have to say?
So off we go into season two, and it starts in a silly place. I can see why this was moved down to episode 7 when they were broadcast. Yeah.
Oh, damn, that would have saved me a lot of work if I'd read that first. Thanks a million, Boss, for being so late.
It would have made for a weak season opener, yeah. To me, it felt like a mishmash of season one episodes hastily thrown together. There was the medieval set we had before and a character who resembled a less camp squire of Gothos. The hypnotised crew reminded me of Return of the Archons, and of course we had another godlike superpowered alien race. There was a lot of silly stuff thrown in, like floating witches' heads, although I did like Spock's line about the bad poetry, and the giant cat. There wasn't much jeopardy in the episode because I didn't find either of the aliens vaguely threatening. Kirk didn't seem to mind snogging Sylvia despite the fact she was only a cat a few minutes earlier.
He likes to snog some pussy.
On the plus side, we did get introduced to Chekhov, who was sporting a very 60s haircut and got plenty of lines. I did like that someone in a red shirt got to sit in the captain's chair. It shows they can do things other than die.
Yeah, it should have been Uhura, though.
It should have been Uhura. I got some amusement by laughing at it, but it was a poor episode overall. I didn't even get much amusement from laughing at it, I'm afraid.
Yes, it was insufficient laughter.
It was insufficient anything, really.
Insufficient quality, certainly. Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
We've also heard from Jeff. In the excellent History of Halloween series from Hypnagoria, I learned that this was one of the first Halloween-themed television episodes, so it has that going for it.
Ah.
Yes, we made reference to that as well. Do listen to Hypnagoria. Jim covering all sorts of weird and wonderful things. Right.
What did Sampo and Yona make of this?
Hello.
Hello.
So we just watched Catspaw.
What happens in it? other than slow gazes or even slower walking. I liked oboe music.
Okay, good.
It's the one thing I did like.
Captain, don't let her touch your wand.
For fuck's sake.
So I'm guessing the pancake episode isn't the worst episode of Star Trek you've ever seen anymore.
What?
The last episode, you said it was the worst episode you've ever seen. I'm assuming that's not the case anymore.
Well, technically.
Oh, come on.
No, this is... Yes.
Thought so. I mean, yeah, it was just so slow.
Why did they make this episode?
Well, they need like 24 episodes per season or something, so...
Okay.
Can't all be winners.
Oh my god.
I mean, what do we need to say about this?
I could relate to the skeleton guy hanging in the wall, just dying of boredom.
I mean, I guess this was a Halloween episode. By design. I don't know. They mentioned trick or treating so many times. But...
If Halloween is boredom, then yes.
Well, I mean, at least the aliens in reality didn't look like humans.
I liked them. They were sympathetic.
Yeah, they look like marionettes.
I wonder why.
Yeah.
They were nice. I really liked the puppets.
Mm.
And then the makers killed the puppets. And then I kind of hated the makers just because they did two things. They did this fucking boring episode and then they killed the one thing that was good in it.
Okay.
Well, I didn't like the aliens when they were humans. I hated them and I hated the way that it was the woman and wanting all the luxury, like the oldest, like...
Ooh, and cook. I must have you.
Oh, and everything like that.
Okay, I mean, I hated them more when... Well, her more when she was a cat. I mean, the same few shots and the stupid shadow.
Not the self.
Yeah.
Make sure that you won't get so big that you cannot go to the dungeon where your prey is. Because that's a little bit stupid.
Yes, very stupid. I mean, the whole episode was stupid. I mean, I know I've seen this before, but I remembered almost nothing about it. The only thing I remembered was that when they had the little Enterprise. Okay, I remember that, but I remembered nothing else about this episode.
And what was the thing with Spock saying that it's unlogic that every creature in this universe wouldn't know human science?
Yeah, I mean, that's not very logical, Spock Milady. Yeah. Well, I mean, at least we saw the debut of Alfred Bester in Star Trek.
What?
Psycho Babylon 5, Chekhov. Yeah, okay, flew right over your head. Never mind.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but I think that the job working as doctor in Enterprise kind of place, it's the worst job ever because you just get charmed all the time. And then you have to fight with Kirk.
Yeah, this was like the second time in 3 episodes, so yeah.
He has his head sore in the morning.
Yeah. Unless, I mean, he seemed fine when the illusion was gone. I mean, was even the fighting an illusion? I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I guess that's it. Yeah.
That's so it.
Let's hope the next episode is better. I mean, it's probable that the next episode is better, but let's see.
Well, would it be logical?
Indeed. I don't know. There was no ending joke in this episode, which was, well, I think that's a relief because
the ending joke was...
The episode itself.
No, the ending joke was these two creatures dying because it's Star fucking Trek and it relates to the time we live and we are killing all the animals and then Star Trek is doing that too. When there's only two.
Well, I mean, they weren't the only two. They were some. Okay, fine. See you hear from you next week. Bye bye.
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 They were about as impressed with it as we were.
Yeah, some love for the puppets, though.
Yeah.
Do you think she thought they were Moomins?
They didn't look like Moomins to me.
They didn't look like anything to me, other than pipe cleaners. But there you go.
Terrible.
And you're right, McCoy does go through a lot, doesn't he, bless him? He's kind of the O'Brien of the original series,
isn't
he?
Yes, he is a bit, That's going to go over Eona's head.
Yeah. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Next up, we hear from the Llama God.
Longer's locks, got the figgy tree, wouldn't you? When, if in our imagination we turn away from the Earth and think about other planets, other less fortunate stars, we realise that life type might be very different. Well then, season 2 of the original series, and we start with, presuming what is going to be called a classic, and it's yet another intriguing and thought-provoking episode, one of the deep ones that dares to ask, what if cats ran stuff and were really big? It'd be a bit weird, because, you know, cats are bastards. I mean, I love cats, I have had a cat, definitely more cat person than a dog person, but, you know, cats are bastards, I'm not going to debate that at all. So, glad we figured that out. Right, so that's all, okay, fine. This episode, this is a weird one, isn't it? I mean, yes, it's definitely the Halloween Halloween episode. Netflix had it down as not being the first episode in season 2, but I can assume that it was made first because it had all the weirdness to it, and then it was saved until October for Halloween. I'm guessing that's what it was for anyway. And I guess it kind of works, isn't it? It's not a deep, meaningful episode, but to be honest, it's a lot of fun, and I didn't mind it that much. In a show such as Star Trek, where you are going from planet to planet every week, or at least that's what it was in the original series, then yeah, certainly there's room for basically pulp sci-fi romps like this one. Occasionally, why not? It's a bit unfortunate, I guess, that it comes straight off the back of the flying pancakes from last week, or at least the way we watched it in production order. But all the same, there's not room for it, so yeah, it doesn't do anything particularly deep, but the cast are good enough, it all rattles along, and yeah, it's just enjoyable. It's not the best episode I've ever seen, but far, far from being the worst. The conceit that they're just two aliens controlling everything, I mean, yeah, that's classic Star Trek, isn't it? The reveal at the end that they're just clangers, yeah, I mean, that's just funny. There's actually an element of pathos as well as patheticness to their reveal as just being these small Sioux Dragon bothering creatures, and that's just to show that, you know, every form of life in the universe isn't big and mighty. There is indeed infinite diversity in infinite combinations or something like that. So yeah, it's Star Trek, they're doing alien aliens. I mean, they're not very convincing. Remember, this is the 1960s, 1960 TV budget, but at least we don't get to see them as plasma energy things or unconvincing humanoids. They're just little puppets, and yeah, I'm kind of okay with that, to be honest. The human avatars, the aliens, are also fun as well. There is, unfortunately, the obvious downside of rampant sexism when it comes to Sylvia, because she's obviously just there as the one to be seduced and should behave like a typical woman. Apparently, a woman should have compassion, says Kirk. Yeah, well, what else should a woman have? Like, do you have any more rules there? Yeah, it's a bit icky, isn't it? It's a bit icky. It's not ideal. But she stands up to them quite well enough, I think. Even if she does have to take the role of the one who is seduced. And is this the first time that Kirk's pulled out the "let me show you the meaning of this thing that we humans call love" line? Is that the first time? I think it is. And actually, I wasn't keeping count at all, but I think, is this only the third woman that Kirk snogged in the run so far? I think it might be. I need to go back on this, so we need to actually get a Kirk snog count up now we're into the second season. I'll let that one slip by, unfortunately. The actor playing Kolob is also great. He's just the amount of despair, disdain, and general not wanting to be there-ness that he gives off throughout the episode. It's like, yes, he is a potential antagonist, but he kind of doesn't want to be there either, and his bafflement at times is nice. It's just, he's nicely played. It's just, it's a fun, silly haunted house romp. I don't really have a problem with that. We do also get introduced to Chekhov, who is somewhat overshadowed by, and I've forgotten his name now, the other engineering bloke who's at the con, who does a pretty stern but good job. I mean, he's only second in command. He doesn't want to fuck anything up when Scotty gets back, so I can see why he took the stance he does. And yeah, Chekhov is kind of overshadowed, really, in his first appearance. He's not much of a muchness there, unfortunately. And it's a terrible, terrible wig. And we also get to see DeForest Kelly's name finally in the opening credits, which is a good thing for him, because, you know, his name is front and centre, but also probably a bad thing for the rest of the cast, as in this episode, but also the previous few we've covered as well, is that we're now just focusing on the big three and not anyone else, which is a bit of a disappointment. But yeah, as season openers go, this wasn't bad. It was entertaining enough. And yeah, why not have some more? Okay, I don't think there's much to say about this one, really, is there? I mean, I guess I'll find out when I listen to find out what everyone else made of these, and whether there is something deep there that I've just been missing, because I'm just back to work and I don't want to be. I hope that everybody else is equally thrilled to be back to the grindstone. And until next time, glory to you and your cast.
Thank you.
Thank you. Having just spent half an hour cleaning up cat sick, I can confirm that they're gits.
Yeah, he also went to a clangers place. So it's not just us. I hadn't noticed the thing about DeForest Kelly being in the credits, yes, having not been in there, if you see what I mean. Uh-huh. I didn't notice the change. Was it a big thing at the time?
It presumably was for him. One would hope it might even mean more money. I mean, it's only right, because they're the three main characters. They ought to be up there. But yeah, and also, you know, he was arguably better known on television than possibly Nimoy and Shatner. I'm not sure. Yeah. Certainly he'd had a longer career, yeah, on television, but then he was older. So yeah, I'm glad he's up there.
Okay.
But I think there's a fine line between pulp and pap, and for me,
pap.
Yes, it is a bit. But I'm glad you enjoyed it more than we did.
Yes, glad somebody enjoyed it. What about Drew and Tracy? Does Drew think this is a classic?
So we just watched Catspaw.
We did.
Moo, shush. And what did we think of that one then?
It was not the best.
Why?
Why? It's not a classic, and it's also not iconic.
Are you literally saying this is not a classic?
It's not a classic, it's not iconic. It's Halloween episode, isn't it? They've deliberately made Halloween episode. Story's not good. Just no way. Not very good.
What the shit? I was actually quite like intrigued by this episode the whole way through. Because I was just a bit like, what the fuck is happening?
Yeah, I know. You see, it's very random.
Yeah, so like, It was great to see Chekhov. Let's go to some points. Yes. It was great to see Chekhov.
Yes.
But what in the fuck was going on with his hairdo?
He had a bit of a barnet going on,
He had like a big Frankenstein hairdo, like cut across the fringe and stuff like that.
I think the idea was to make him like the young kind Beatles-esque kind of look. Because the Beatles were big around the time, so that's what the idea was. But that wig is too big for his head.
And then some, yes. No, that was just crazy. So they go onto the planet and then they find out that obviously something freaky oid is going on.
Yep.
And then you see the castle.
Yep. And the witches.
And the witches was really freaky.
I know. Yeah.
You know, and then, but you didn't see anything more of them, which was a bit like, what was that? It was a bit random. So that castle... I said to you, it's either like Dracula's castle or it's the Wicked Witch of the West from The Wizard of Oz.
Wizard of Oz, yes.
It just looked too familiar and you said, oh, it's because
it's just Paramount set, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. But is that what in the frigging frock is going on?
I think that's the trouble with this episode, though. It's just like, where's going on now? It's just a load of scenes of like... Oh, let's put some witches and some ghosts. And
then Scotty and Sulu come out and they're all like...
It's just not very cohesive, the whole episode.
They're drugged up to their eyeballs with some witch juice going on. And then, like, Bones gets, like, sucked into that kind of weirdness. Mm. And then the irony of Bones staring at Bones being chained up. And it's just like...
And then, like, you know, Kirk uses his masculinity to try and, like... trick Sylvia. It's good that she sees through it, though.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I just don't think it's a great episode myself.
I quite enjoyed it up to the end bit.
When the cat was big. I don't mean you got it, was it?
You
was going like, why don't I run away from the cat? And then when, like, I think when the door opens in the dungeon and it's like big,
but it doesn't explain how the cat gets big.
No, I know they don't.
So all of a sudden, like, so as soon as like the cat whispers into the bald guy's ear and he goes, oh yeah, go for it. You know that when she comes out, that's the cat. So I kind of got that bit. And then all of a sudden, the cat, well, she disappears and the cat, like,
comes out,
and it's like about 8 foot tall. And it's like, I don't understand how that's happened.
No, I mean, it's not really explained.
And then, like, I said to you, all the cat's got to do is, like, put its paw through the hole and, like, swipe them all. It just got a bit daft at the end.
It did. Well, talking about the end, I was saying to you, go, do not miss the money shot at the end of the little creatures.
And I was like, oh.
I know, you was like, oh.
So cute. And again, I said to you, Gene Roddenberry must have taken some, like, spliffy
pills. There's a lot of acid going around at the end of the 60s, wasn't there? I was just saying that.
Because it just don't fucking make sense, does it?
No, it's not terrible. Just not a great episode, I'd say.
I was really intrigued, like, at the beginning. I was thinking, oh, this is quite scary, and, like, I'm really into this. And then it just got...
Yeah, goes off the rails.
Stupid.
Yep.
Anyway, leave it there.
Okie dokie.
See you later, guys. Bye.
Yeah, you're right. It is a bit sort of random, isn't it? It's not really very cohesive at all.
No. It's not the best written piece of sci-fi ever.
It's written anything, really.
And witch juice. And ironic, their Catspaw feedback was featured a cat, which is quite sweet. And finally, Porre.
Hello, orgs. Porre here. Sorry I'm being a bit furtive. I'm being pursued by 3 witches who... have apparently found out that I've been hinting at which episode had the worst aliens in all of TOS, and they've suddenly worked out it's Catspaw, but I think I've given them the slip at the moment, so I'll give them a feedback to the episode. Now, this was the first first produced episode of Season 2 TOS, but it wasn't the first aired. The first aired, I believe, was A Mock Time, and it's a much stronger episode to lead off. This one, in fairness, it does do one of the things like TOS doing, which is having space being dangerous, there's a godlike alien around every corner, but also having these kind of big concepts, you know, the non-human aliens. Sadly, of course, the concept did not meet the budget or execution. those weird puppets for Cobol and Sylvia are, they are, like I say, they are the worst alien you will see in TOS, bar none. Worse than the sick pancake monsters, all of it. And, you know, like I say, that's a decent idea, and it's got a decent teaser. You know, the teaser with the guy beaming up and then basically speaking as if he's being spoken through and then dying was interesting. But after that, once they'd spent the time meandering on the planet's surface for, 10 minutes or so, just through wind, seeing our really iffy witches again, the concept was good. The makeup was not up to that at all. Maybe it looked better in the 60s because Pinsharp's crikey vision is doing it no favours. And generally milling about castles for ages, and everything seemed to be so slow. You know, Scotty and Sulu slowly walk up and unlock their shackles. You know, I know it's doing talky, big budget, you know, big concept sci-fi, and they can use old sets for it. But, you know, and I didn't like the fact that it was the woman who was the one who was corrupted by all the sensation. She wanted to feel more, specifically with Kirk's magic wand. You know, and she'd become cruel and addicted to it and was offering him the power of a god. And of course, only Kirk can turn it down. Also, the daft idea of beaming all your senior staff down. You've already got Scotty, who usually takes the bridge when everyone's away, and Sulu on the planet's surface. But Kirk decides, well, I'd best take Spock with me and the main doctor. So we get DeSalle in charge. Again, would have been better being Uhura, but that was never going to happen in the 60s. But yeah, you've got the DeSalle. I'm sure we've seen DeSalle before, but I could be wrong. Name rings a bell. And of course, the other person we see is Mr. Chekhov, new cast addition. Obviously, we know him well. And you can tell that this was first in production because his wig is particularly awful in this. It's really just, you know, doesn't look like they've combed it. It almost looks like it's been dropped in his head and then he's been kind of punted out onto stage doing his Russian accent. You know, he was meant to be the young heartthrob character that's cashing in the monkeys and kind of having a Russian there as well. More on him probably in future episodes. But yeah, overall, it just seemed a lot of milling about. We've got some fairly shonky giant cat stuff as well. And Kirk and Sylvia kind of having bad gender politics. So yeah, overall, not an auspicious start to the season. And like I say, I mean, I suppose the upshot of this is we know our worst alien effects are behind us now. There's the daft, horrible puppet aliens can't hurt you anymore. They're gone, they're in the past, so we have that. And we have good episodes to look forward to. Like I said, a mock time. But yeah, a bit of a weak start to the season. Overall, it's still good to be feeding back, and it's good to be doing TOS. I'll hopefully feed back in the next episode. Do keep up the good work, guys. And thanks for all your hard work. But until the next time, I'll be saying bye for now.
Bye.
Worst aliens ever.
Yeah, possibly. Quite possibly. they are amazingly feeble.
They are. I think the reason I found the pancake ones worse is these only feature a very small amount of the time at the end, if you see what I mean. But they are bloody awful. And yeah, just like the Llama God as well, you didn't like the fact that it's the woman that gets corrupted and...
Yeah.
It's of its time.
It's very much of its time, yes.
I mean, it's. I mean, she must be corrupted and a bit bonkers to have fallen for Kirk. Mm-hmm. It could have been... Because the thing is, these days, they could potentially do a sensation-seeking man, but those days, they would not have done that.
No.
We
had seen DeSalle before. It's his third appearance.
It's just he's a bit wooden, so we hadn't noticed.
Yes, quite. Well, he had smaller roles before, but definitely putting him front of centre wasn't a good idea, I don't think.
No, not an intelligent thing to have done.
Well, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next time, we shall be covering... Well, in a week's time, we start Lower Decks Season 3.
Yay!
Recording Wednesday the 18th of January, we'll be covering Grounded. And then 2 weeks' time, Wednesday the 25th, we're covering Metamorphoses, which interestingly has something in common with Grounded. They both feature Zefran Cochrane, although not the same actor.
Okay.
But there we go. Yes, thematic. It's like it was planned, which it blatantly wasn't. Right. We'll catch you next time. Cheery bye.
Bye, boy.
In a town near Albuquerque, lived the most concerned young boy.
The opening music for this podcast was provided by the talented Drew Barker.
The artwork was created by Andy Pelastides.
All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
find our website at borgcast.libsyn.com.
And we have a YouTube channel as well.
You can find the Borgcast playouts on Spotify for your listening pleasure.
Visit our Tumblr site at borgcast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send emails or MP3s to borgcast@gmail.com.
The young New Mexican puppeteer, he saw the people all lived in fear. He thought that maybe they'd listen to a puppet telling them what to do. And now he got some string and he got some wood. He did some carving and he was good. And folks came running so they could hear the young New Mexican puppeteer. First he carved out young Abe Lincoln.
Shut it down!